it's really getting to a point where we're thinking of myeloma maybe as more of a chronic disease that you can live with. It's just amazing.
When we talk around being ambitious for patients, this is really now our responsibility to bring that through.
We're really talking about more years for people and more time in those years being healthy.
Hello everyone, my name's Oyiza and I'm joined today by my colleagues Jack Harris and Lydia Eckersley, who are working to change the lives of people living with multiple myeloma. Jack, Lydia, when I was doing a bit of research, I was thinking about multiple myeloma. Mm-hmm. Confession, I hadn't actually heard of it before working at GSK. Does it affect certain populations more than others?
I think latest stats have maybe got around 180,000 people diagnosed per year globally. So, you know, it maybe doesn't get as much of the attention of the likes of, you know, your breast cancers or your lung cancers or prostates. So it's more common in the older population. It's more prevalent in the African or Afro-Caribbean population.
And did I read it's more prevalent in men than women? As well?
That's correct. I mean, there's not a huge difference, but just slightly more common, yes. And we don't really understand why that is at the moment.
Which is why research is so important.
Exactly.
When I think of cancer, I think of checking for lumps or tumours forming, but multiple myeloma is different, right? Could you share a little bit about what it is?
So it is a form of what we call a blood cancer, but it's actually really starts in the bone marrow. The plasma cells grow out of control. There are too many of them. And instead of producing healthy antibodies, they make an abnormal protein. And that can be picked up on a blood test. More often, it presents with other symptoms. So in particular, it can cause problems with the bones. It can also cause anemia. So that's because the bone marrow is full of these plasma cells, and it affects the production of normal, healthy red blood cells. So that leaves patients feeling very tired. It can also cause kidney problems because a bit of the protein breaks off and can go into the kidneys and clog up the kidneys.
It sounds like a really complex picture. If I turned up to my GP, for example, with back pain and tiredness, you know, or anemia, my mind would not go to cancer.
And I think the other thing that exacerbates that challenge is when you think about the average age of diagnosis is late 60s. You know, your average late 60, early 70-year-old is probably going to be complaining of fatigue, bone pain, potential kidney dysfunction.
I mean, Jack's completely right. Typically, patients will have been to their GP, you know, maybe two or three times with back pain, feeling tired, and unless the GP thinks of doing those tests, I mean, they're not going to send every patient with back pain for blood tests because most of the time the back pain isn't due to myeloma. And this is why sometimes patients do end up coming into hospital really, really sick.
How much time are we talking about here for patients with this diagnosis in terms of overall survival?
60% of people will be alive after 5 years from their initial diagnosis. And that's come a long way, right? We have seen great progress. It used to be in the 30, 40% maybe 10 years ago. But it still means that, you know, 40% of people are not even living 5 years. You know, being able to have some treatment that, you know, reduces that need for them to be constantly in and out of hospital is a big thing that we hear from patients a lot.
Maybe something we haven't touched on yet is the relapse-remitting nature of multiple myeloma. What's that actually mean in practice for patients?
So myeloma is not curable. And what we know is that we can treat it, but after a certain period of time, it will come back. And unfortunately, when it comes back, it tends to be resistant to the treatments that were used the first time, particularly because the treatments are usually carried on until it progresses or comes back.
And what we often hear from patients as they go through this period of remission and then relapse.
You know, when the patient first starts treatment, that they're often quite sick. They just want to get on with the treatment. But when that first time comes where their disease is progressing and you have to break that news to them, they do find that really, really difficult to deal with because they might have been expecting many years and then they think, gosh, we're not, you know, I'm not going to have so long. So yes, you really have to deal with all the emotions as well as the actual what treatment you're going to give.
Lydia, can you talk to us about what's next for multiple myeloma?
There's obviously been loads of treatments over the last few years, and it's really getting to a point where we're thinking of myeloma maybe as more of a chronic disease that you can live with rather than it shortening your life. So it's just amazing.
What are you excited about, Jack?
We have a quote from one of our patients that we asked them, what is it that you're looking for from a treatment in myeloma? And they quoted this phrase that we now use a lot of, I'm looking for more years in my life, but also more life in my years. Mm. And that makes me excited. We talk around being ambitious for patients. This is really now our responsibility to bring that through. And then more longer term, we are looking to make GSK a powerhouse in oncology.
Thank you so much, Jack, Lydia. I've learned a lot, and I hope that people listening have too.